What is the significance of timekeeping? What is the significance of a watch? My current marathon JDD is off for warranty work because the crown and stem unscrewed completely out. So I got one of these trendy Vostok watches. Horology aficionados seem to speak highly of it, but I was actually quite disappointed. It looks and feels like a toy. The major feature that I see on it is that it's water resistant. It's tiny. The luminescence is very weak and brief. The bezel doesn't ratchet and kind of moves bidirectionally. It doesn't really have a quick set. You have to hack between 8 and 1 p.m. The watch band is polyurethane, although they called it leather. The steel seems very high gloss and low quality. The crystal is just plastic, it's acrylic. And it does have supposedly 200 meter resistance, and it does have a date function, although it's so tiny that with my old eyes, it's almost impossible to use. And it does have an anti-shock balance, kind of like the old Inca block systems. The crown screws down, it's got 31 power reserve, and it is handmade, hand-built in the Christopol watch factory in Russia, which has some tradition of supplying their military. But I guess this will do until my marathon comes back. But today I want to focus on talking about watches a little bit and American horology, mostly. I've always, going back to when I was about 7, 8 years old, always had watches and wore watches because it's practical and useful in daily work and at school, for instance. The watch that we wear today, however, is actually a representation of the rotation of the planetary bodies and the stars and our sun especially. As humans, we keep track of our brief time on Earth this way. The first timekeeping methods used by our ancestral hominids was the simple act of looking up at the sun, the moon, and the stars. Early man could probably tell time by the stars and sun using their own contrived methods. But eventually, water clocks were used in the Far East 6,000 years ago. Sundials were in use 4,000 years ago by the Egyptians, for instance. Ancient mariners used hourglasses 3,000 years ago. And the very first pendulum mechanical clocks were in use 800 years ago by Galileo and his peers. Timekeeping was successively refined as mechanical pieces up to the point of the superior timekeeping of the quartz clocks in the early 20th century. Now, quartz is a crystal of silicon dioxide, which has the piezoelectric property of bending, oscillating, when accumulating electrical charges on its surface. When subjected to the constant electrical signals as from a battery, these oscillations are exceedingly regular. Now, this property was first parlayed into quartz timepieces in around 1970. It was found to be an order of magnitude more accurate than the mechanical watches of the day. Nowadays, of course, the time standard is no longer based directly on observing the Earth's rotation, which was found in the 19th century to be disappointingly irregular. Today, the weighted average of over 400 cesium atomic clocks kept at over 50 national laboratories worldwide are studied and adjusted by GPS satellite signals by the International Bureau of Weights and Measures in Sèvres, France. But ultimately, the international time standard is still a reflection of the measurement of the rotation of the heavenly bodies. Now, I've worn a variety of watches since I was a child, including my Laura's Mickey Mouse watch and other plastic toy type watches. The very first watch that I got that was any good was a Seiko that my uncle bought me around 1975. And I also had one of those prototype red LCD digital watches around that time, which I destroyed in a swimming pool. I bought my first pocket watch when I was around 9. The reason so many of my hobbies began around age 9 was this was when my parents first granted me an allowance. Now, the year 1976 was not so good for hobbyism because hobbyism was a rather primitive, solitary business back then. I mean, we didn't have the internet or anything like that. Now, we did have showroom-style retail stores like The Best Company or Sam Solomon, if you guys remember any of those places. And this is the type of place where I bought my first timepieces, like pocket watches. Now, there I would get Laura's pocket watches, Jules Jurgensen pocket watches, Westclock's dollar watches. But they always went dead, and they wouldn't come back. One I accidentally had in my pocket when I jumped in the pool, but more or less they more often just kind of died on their own. And when I opened them up, I couldn't figure out what went wrong with them. 40 years ago, there was no resource for easy research. I grew up away from big city libraries, so research was pretty hopeless, and I didn't know anyone else interested in pocket watches or watches in general. So I bought these series of crappy watches, pocket watches, hand-wound or otherwise, which all promptly broke within weeks or months. Never had any luck with them. And I didn't know what the good ones were back then. It was only decades later that I discovered the complete price guide to watches by Cooksey Sugart. Now, the things I learned during those years of little research, less knowledge, and many bad choices were that the quartz pocket watch go dead without warning. I think it's mostly from water ingress or moisture accumulation creating electrical shorts, or dust or moisture creating electronic meltdowns or whatever. And over the years, as you all know too, electronics are often not so reliable. Batteries go dead, batteries leak. There's also fairly flimsy, plasticky construction to electronics. Even in the most expensive quartz watches costing hundreds of dollars. And what I eventually learned is that mechanical watches are more reliable, superior over long periods of time. And in the realm of pocket watches, what I learned was to stick to four major American brands from the golden age of pocket watches of the 1890s to 1930s. So Hamilton's, Illinois, Elgin's, and Waltham's are found in abundance because they had very high production runs on mass assembly factory lines 100 years ago. So although they can cost tens of thousands for the rare collector's items variant, usually these are the very earliest ones wound and set by keys. For a simple users and appreciators, you can be very happy with a serviceable railroad type or railroad grade watches costing maybe $100 to $500. There are people now who enjoy servicing these for a fee of a few hundred dollars or so. So carrying one has again become practical because you can get these very delicate parts oiled and serviced whenever you need them to be. Now, servicing and repairing watches is its own very arcane hobby, which can take up the bulk of your time. And maybe I'll be interested in stuff like that someday, but I just don't have the time right now, so I prefer just appreciating them and sending them out to people who just love to work on them. So these pocket watches from the railroad age refer to that time period, like I said, 100 years ago or so. And that time period coincided with the rise of the railroads since around and just after the Civil War. In 1891, there was a catastrophic train collision around somewhere in Michigan when an engineer's pocket watch went dead for about 4 minutes, causing ultimately a head-on collision, killing both engineers and many passengers. And since that time, a man named Mr. Ball wrote a scathing editorial in a national newspaper calling for the standardization of railroad watches. These watches were declared and deemed to be life critical for the operation of the railroads. Locomotives at the time were massive building-sized conglomerations of industrial steel and glass barreling down the railroad tracks at 60 miles per hour. And the timings for their switching and arrivals had to be extremely precise. Using supremely reliable timepieces, lives were at stake. So the office of the time inspector was first installed in Michigan, where that catastrophic 1891 crash occurred. And by 1893, very specific standards were invoked. The standards for the railroad chronometer included an open-face design like this one. The numbers had to be clear black Arabic. The sizes have to be 18, and that's measured at the movement plate. There had to be a minimum of 17 jewels, ruby or sapphire jewels. Now, these are aluminum oxide gems, which act as friction-reducing, wear-resisting bearings at the pivots and the gearing points within the watch. It helps to keep the watches reliable so they don't jam up and stop the way that catastrophic engineer's watch did in 1891. The watches had to be adjusted in at least 5 positions. Also, temperature compensated for freezing and extremely hot weather as well. The watches, you know, are kept in the pocket, so face up, face down, crown up, crown left, crown right, and the sixth position is crown down. These are the typical positions within the watch of an engineer's pocket. So they were adjusted and monitored in those positions to make sure they kept accuracy of a maximum variation of 30 seconds per week, which is 4 seconds per day. Phenomenal accuracy, even for mechanical watches nowadays. Now, these watches also had to be lever set. Unlike the modern watches, which are, you know, adjusted with a pendant pulled out, these levers, which pull out like that, can then allow the hands to be moved, and then with a lever pushed back in, the inspector of time on the railroads would then seal the timepiece so that the engineer and nobody else could tamper with it. So they had to be adjusted at specific periods of every few days by the time inspector to keep it absolutely accurate. And the features of the movement that were standard included anti-magnetic protection, micrometer adjustment regulators, double roller escapements. Now the steel or the brass balance, as you can see there, had to be weighted and balanced. And this balance is the heart of a mechanical watch. The balance is very analogous to the pendulum in a clock. They are adjustable. And during the peak of the pocket watch era, whereas noted, extremely, extremely accurate. With these types of standards in place, the American pocket watch of the 1890s were the most supremely accurate timepieces in the world. Initially, Walthams and Elgins served as railroad watches, artisan pieces created by the Illinois Watch Company and Hamilton, eventually took over by the 1890s and were adopted as the certified railroad chronometer of the age. Of course, the pocket watch and American horology in general really took root in around the 1850s at the hands of Waltham of Waltham, Massachusetts. Back in 1850, a group of businessmen founded the American Horologue Company in Roxbury. And after folding a number of companies into it and renaming themselves several times, Warren Manufacturing, Boston Watch Company, Appleton Tracy Company, and then the American Watch Company, they ultimately named themselves the American Waltham Watch Company, AWWC, which even later on was shortened to Waltham Watch Company. These were the watches worn by Abraham Lincoln in 1863. And they were so supremely accurate for the age that in 1875, during an international exposition in Philadelphia, Waltham watches, mass-produced on factory lines, beat out all the Swiss and European companies' inaccuracy. And this was called the American crisis in Swiss watch-making history. But soon thereafter, the Swiss adopted all those factory line production methods of Waltham to catch up and then regain their lead in watchmaking by the early mid-20th century. Watchmaking, of course, originated in Europe using their guild system of artisans and craftsmen. But once Waltham showed the superiority of applying those methods, the Swiss fell in line and came to do that as well. Now, Waltham produced many of their famous pocket watches in a multitude of grades within their models, which were typically named after years, like the 1883 year, 1892, 1879, 1877, etc. There are multiple grades, included the very top line, the American grade, the Appleton Tracy grade, then followed by the Waltham watch grade, Crescent Street, P.S. Bartlett, like this one, William Mallory, like Abraham Lincoln's watch. Though Waltham did well for many, many years, after Royal Robbins died, the leadership in the company was unable to keep up with the higher financial acumen of Elgin, Illinois, and Hamilton. By 1945, they were just struggling along, trying to produce clocks and wristwatches, and Waltham ceased all production of watches by 1957. Now, Elgin, which was formed when a group of businessmen went off to tour Waltham's factories in 1864, lured seven of Waltham's key machinists with the 555 promise. 5 years of salaries of $5,000 and bonuses of $5,000, which is millions of dollars in today's money. The seven machinist stars became the linchpin to the Elgin National Watch Company, which eventually became the largest American watch manufacturer. Originally called the National Watch Company, they built a 35-acre factory in Elgin, Illinois in 1866. The very first movements were made in 1867, and their pieces were sold for the exorbitant price of $115, which in the day was equivalent to thousands of dollars, an entire year's salary for a working man. Elgin ultimately began focusing on kind of moderate to lower priced movements, and their motto was to create pocket watches for the common man. They produced watches also in giant assembly line production like Waltham, but at a scale not imagined by even Waltham. 50 million of these pieces a year during their peak years, which is why the Elgin pocket watches are so easily found nowadays. Their well-made watches were also used in railroads early on, and Elgin grew into a huge watch business. During 1920 to 1928, they produced more than half of all pocket watches in the United States. Now, several of the key seven machinists at Elgin were lured away by even additional money to start another new watch company, the Illinois Watch Company, in 1870 by John Adams and John Bunn. Elgin's production expanded to wristwatches also, and they remained a primary watchmaker for the people into the 20th century. Though they did well for over 100 years, by 1968, all of their operations ceased in the United States, in Elgin, Illinois. And though there's another company that uses the Elgin name nowadays, that company has no relationship to these vintage Elgins. Now, the Illinois Watch Company started as the Springfield Watch Company. It was organized in 1869 by a former lawyer partner of Abe Lincoln's, J.C. Adams. He brought on board several deep-pocketed men, and they enticed those stars who absconded to the Elgin Watch Factory from Waltham to come on board to start another big company. They even enticed one of Elgin's superintendents to come on board to supervise the whole thing as well. And they built a factory in Springfield, Illinois on 14 acres. Their first movements were produced in 1876, and full production began in earnest in 1875, initially as key-wound, key-set watches. But in their prime, Illinois increasingly focused on a line of only extremely fine, supremely accurate, high-grade railroad standard watches, like the Sangamo, the Bun Special, the Santa Fe. Illinois always seemed to have financial difficulties, so they produced under contracts for several businesses, including the Burlington Watch in Chicago, Plymouth, which was a Sears Roebuck brand, as well as for Montgomery Ward. Only when Jacob Bun came on board as president in 1878 did they start to stabilize a little bit. And they were the ones to produce the very first open face watch design like these. Starting in 1903, Illinois followed only the railroad standard grade movements and discontinued all of their cheaper movements. They were one of the very first to realize the importance of producing only very premium watches. Their name became renowned for that reason. And at peak production, they only produced about 5 million movements yearly, which is 10 times fewer than what Elgin produced. But each of their movements were extremely premium. Eventually, the company was produced by the more financially astute Hamilton Watch Company in 1927, and Hamilton discontinued the Illinois name by 1932. Hamilton Watch is the last man standing in American pocket watch horology. Was incorporated fairly late in 1892 by Perry and Adams, and produced their very first pocket watch in 1893 out of their factory in Lancaster, Pennsylvania. Their history actually goes back to 1886 when Abram Bittner bought out the Lancaster Watch Company and folded it into his company, the Keystone Standard. And although he went bankrupt, it was sold to a company called Hamilton, named after James Hamilton, the man who owned all the tracts of land, including Lancaster, from the original Penn Charter. They folded in some other companies, like the Aurora Watch of Illinois, and they built a 13-acre factory in Lancaster, producing, at the time initially, the number of watches that Waltham and Elgin did, about 2 million movements a year. But Hamilton never went past that level of production, as they increasingly focused on the highest grade, the most premium movements that they could produce. By 1900, Hamilton was making the 940 movement, like this one, which at time was one of the most superbly designed and accurate and reliable watch in the world. With their model 992, their most famous model, the American Railroad System eventually agreed to buy Hamilton's entire production every year, and their financial future was thereby assured. During this time, Hamilton owned 56% of the watch market. During World War I, Hamilton focused on supplying the U.S. military with their 992 pocket watches and adroitly retooled to produce wristwatches for soldiers. And using such adroit business acumen, Hamilton was able to beat out their competitors, Waltham, Elgin. They were even able to buy out their main competition, Illinois Watch, by 1928 by offering $5 million to the heirs of the Bun fortune. Well into the 1930s and 1940s, it was Hamilton whose watches were the railroad standard. After fighting off hostile takeover bids by Benrus, Hamilton acquired the Buren Watch Factory of Switzerland in 1966. By 1969, Hamilton ceased all American manufacturing in Lancaster. In 1971, the subsidiary that owned Amiga and Tissot bought out Hamilton, and by 1984, Hamilton became a member of the Swatch Group. And so no longer in American hands, with a direct lineage to American horology. Though you can be successful producing quality watches in high volume if it's still more premium than your competitors, as Waltham did. One can be even more successful and beat out all of your competitors by focusing relentlessly on the highest quality, by bridging the difference between high output assembly line factory production and moving toward the guild-like craftsman artisan perfection that the Swiss focused on. Most people became enamored with quartz watches. Given their superior accuracy, this is understandable for the time, but as I said, quartz watches has many weak points in their construction. They're rather flimsy, with their leak-prone battery, the unreliable silicone computer chips. You never know when they're going to fail, and over time, you're better off trusting in the mechanical watch. Accuracy is a continuum. Quartz may be superior to mechanical watches and mechanisms, but cesium atomic clocks beat out quartz mechanisms. There will always be new technology that will be created. But ultimately, remember, all these earthly measurements of timekeeping are merely representations of the movements of the celestial bodies in our universe, which will always fluctuate and vary. So accuracy really isn't the end game. We must always adjust our time. So with this understanding, mechanical timepieces, with their premium construction, their deep history, and with their visible, beautiful heart, will always be the premium timekeeping device for us. The more premium products will almost always win out in the marketplace. In the film Interstellar, the hero Cooper, played by Matt McConaughey, relays in Morse code the advanced data required to save life on Earth via magnetic field manipulations onto his daughter Amelia's Hamilton khaki mechanical wristwatch. This film's themes of spirituality, love, and the search for meaning in a cold, unsympathetic world is tied together by the motif of time, emphasized not only in their wristwatch communication, but in the time travel, in the clock face design of their spaceship, a personal measurement of the cosmos. Watch this film again, keeping in mind how the mundane timekeeping function we attribute to our wristwatch is elevated to cosmic significance, referencing the humble watch back to its timekeeping origins in the stars. A watch is tuned to keep in sync with the motion of the celestial bodies, reminding us of our place in our universe, as well as of our very limited time alive.